All right. Well, good morning, everyone. I wanted to welcome you all to this year's mid-year review. This is our 24th year of offering, sorry, I think 25th year of offering this comprehensive review of the latest updates and therapeutic advances in the treatment of malignancies. Here is our agenda for today, and we also have programs available at our registration desk. So if you didn't stop by, make sure to sign your name in the registration list. Make sure that we can send that over for all of your CEUs. Just wanted to go over a couple of housekeeping items. Our Wi-Fi password is premium guest. That's all together and all lowercase. We also ask that you please keep your cell phones muted throughout the event. After each presentation, we'll have time for questions, so feel free to ask our speakers. I'll have the microphone and walk around and get those questions. And if you're joining us online, feel free to add those to the chat box or unmute yourselves and ask. The event is being recorded and will be uploaded to our event website at a later date. This event is designed to present a comprehensive review of the latest updates and therapeutic advances in the treatment of malignancies. And I also wanted to thank all of our corporate partners for joining us today, as well as encourage you to visit their exhibits in the next room over during our breaks. The Nebraska Oncology Society would not be able to meet its mission without all of their support. Continuing education credits are available for this event. We'll be sending out the evaluation online. And with that, I'll be turning it over to Dr. Su, who is our program chair for the event and is also the Nebraska Oncology Society secretary and treasurer.
All right, well, welcome. Glad folks were able to come out in person. It's really nice. So I've got the pleasure of welcoming back Dr. Vincent Lam. He's an assistant professor of oncology at Johns Hopkins. He's a clinical translational investigator with special interest in lung cancer. His research includes ongoing efforts to develop the clinical utility of liquid biopsies in cancer. He's also led multiple early phase immunotherapy clinical trials, including T cell therapy trials in lung cancer. He's an investigator with computational bioinformatics expertise, and so he applies genomic analytics to better understand why many lung cancers don't respond to immunotherapy and to develop new immunotherapies for these patients. So, welcome, Vincent. We are thrilled to have you back.
Perfect. Time here. All right. Good morning. Thank you so much for the kind invitation to return this year to discuss the recent updates in lung cancer. It really is a privilege for me to speak at this event. It'll be a bit of a whirlwind tour. There's been a lot going on in lung cancer over the past year or half year or so, but I think we'll get through it. So hopefully you'll find this instructive. Here's my disclosures. So in the spirit of the College World Series that's ongoing, I would say that the past ASCO really has been a home run, really, for lung cancer, with three plenary abstracts, as well as multiple high impact data readouts. And so I'll touch upon several of these this morning, including practice changing developments and both limited stage and small and extensive stage small cell lung cancer. We also saw practice changing data in locally advanced EGFR mutated as well as frontline advanced ALK positive non-small cell lung cancer. And then also much awaited details were presented from the first randomized phase three study of local consolidative therapy in oligometastatic non-small cell lung cancer. And then finally, we'll discuss what I think are practice affirming data in the frontline unresectable mesothelioma space. So, you know, until very recently, there has indeed been very, very slow progress for our small cell lung cancer patients. As an example, for the limited stage setting, the treatment paradigm has largely been the same for several decades. As many of you are aware, this paradigm primarily consists of concurrent chemotherapy plus radiation with cisplatin and etoposide, followed by prophylactic cranial irradiation. Although of note, PCI is currently being re-examined in a randomized phase three study by SWOG, the so-called MAVERICK study that would I would highly recommend patients enroll on, as that's a really important question that's outstanding for this population. And unfortunately, a large majority of these patients with limited stage disease are not cured, despite being treated with curative intent. You see here, the median overall survival is 25 to 30 months for these patients, with a five-year survival rate of only about 25%. And it's against this backdrop that the ADRIATIC study was designed. This is a global randomized phase three study that enrolled patients with stage one to stage three limited stage small cell lung cancer that was deemed inoperable. Important to note that these patients were randomized after successful completion of chemo radiation without progression. And PCI was permitted based on investigators' discretion. So these patients were randomized to durvalumab for total of 2 years or placebo. There was also a third arm evaluating the anti-CTLA-4 tremelimumab in combination with durvalumab, and those results have not yet been presented. Primary endpoints for this study are dual endpoints of OS and PFS. And as you can see here, these were the positive data presented by Dr. Spiegel in the plenary session showing PFS benefit of 7 months in patients who received durvalumab with a hazard ratio of 0.76. Even more impressive was the overall survival benefit that was observed. Patients who received durvalumab had a median overall survival of about 56 months compared to 33 months for placebo, hazard ratio of 0.73. This is an almost 2 year improvement in the median overall survival benefit and is definitely unprecedented for this disease setting. In the pre-specified subgroup analysis, we see that these subgroups generally equally benefited from the addition of durvalumab, although I would call your attention to the fact that patients who received durvalumab sooner after the completion of chemo radiation seemed to do better. And specifically, patients who received the durvalumab within 28 days. And again, this is not new. This is a trend that we saw as well in the PACIFIC study, which, as a reminder, is sort of the analogous study in non-small cell lung cancer, locally advanced non-small cell lung cancer with consolidative durvalumab. Again, it's uncertain what this trend suggests in terms of whether or not it's truly reflective of biology or increased PD-L1 sensitivity, or potentially just more fit patients who progress through chemo radiation without significant toxicity. So fortunately, there was no unexpected toxicity signal in ADRIATIC. The immune-related adverse event prevalence was really tracking well with what we've seen with Pacific and other immunotherapy trials, for example, in the metastatic setting. Of course, pneumonitis is an immune-related adverse event of special consideration in this population. And it was reassuring to see that patients who received durvalumab did not experience significantly higher rates of pneumonitis compared to the control arm. So you can see 38% of patients in the intervention arm experienced pneumonitis of all grades, but only 3.1% grade 3 or higher, and less than 10% required discontinuation of their immunotherapy due to the pneumonitis. So taken together, this really, you know, these results from ADRIATIC really represent the new standard of care for limited stage small cell lung cancer with the addition of durvalumab after chemo radiation. Not presented at ASCO, but fairly recently, the big buzz was in the extensive stage setting for small cell lung cancer, with the FDA granting accelerated approval for tarlatamab in this disease group. So tarlatamab, as you are maybe aware, is a bispecific T-cell engager targeting DLL3, which is an extracellular protein that's ubiquitously expressed in small cell lung cancer. So this is a major, major development in extensive stage small cell lung cancer and really represents, I would say, the tip of the iceberg in terms of the developments coming towards small cell lung cancer in the next few years. And this approval comes on the heels of positive data from the Delphi 301 study, so which was presented at ESMO 2023. So this study is a phase 2 study of relapse refractory extensive stage small cell lung cancer patients who had progressed on at least 2 prior lines of treatment, including platinum-based chemotherapy. And these patients were randomized to one of 2 doses, tarlatamab 10 milligrams or 100 milligrams. And then upon review of the safety data and efficacy data, the 10 milligram dose was selected for further expansion. Primary endpoint for this study was objective response. And, you know, you can see for yourself here, the waterfall plot is really, again, unprecedented in this particular disease setting in patients that are as heavily pretreated. In the selected dose, the dose that was selected to move forward, 10 milligrams, objective response was 40%, again, in patients who have progressed on 2 or more lines of prior therapy. And in patients that did respond, many of them, in fact, most of them actually had responses that lasted more than 6 months. 56% of the responses were ongoing at the time of the data cutoff for publication of this study. And of course, big question about this new class of immunotherapy would be toxicity. And indeed, we see here that low-grade cytokine release syndrome was in fact the most common treatment-related adverse event seen in patients receiving tarlatamab. But fortunately, for the selected dose of 10 milligrams, all of the CRS observed was low grade, meaning that these patients did not require high flow oxygen or pressors. Another important immune related toxicity for this class of T cell directed therapy would be immune effector cell associated neurotoxicity, so-called ICANS. So they did see that in 8% of patients who received the 10 milligram dose, and ICANS primarily occurred after the first dose with a median of 5 days. And CRS primarily occurred within the first 2 doses. All of that is really important because it led the FDA to require that in its approval that patients receive tarlatamab be monitored for 24 hours after cycle one, day one, as well as cycle one, day eight. Of course, this requirement has wide-ranging implications for how quickly and how accessible this treatment can be as cancer centers across the country figure out logistically how to implement this. Oops. Okay, so switching gears to actionable driver genomic alterations, in particular locally advanced EGFR mutated non-small cell lung cancer. So the rationale for giving osimertinib, which as you know, is the new, the third generation EGFR TKI currently used as the standard of care in metastatic EGFR mutated non-small cell lung cancer. The rationale for applying this in the locally advanced setting comes from primarily from two data sets. One, we do know in ad hoc subgroup analyses that the current standard of care for locally advanced disease in non-small cell lung cancer, which is consolidative durvalumab per the PACIFIC study, as I had mentioned, EGFR positive patients do not benefit from the adjuvant, from the consolidative durvalumab. And in fact, it may be detrimental because of the timing of having to wash out the immune checkpoint inhibitor prior to starting the TKI to reduce the incidence of pneumonitis. On the right, you also see that the other rationale comes from positive data from the ADAURA study, which is adjuvant, the use of adjuvant TKI in the resected setting, showing significant PFS benefit with a hazard ratio in the 0.2 range, not shown here, but also an overall survival benefit that you see here. So this is LAURA, also presented in the plenary session. This was a randomized phase 3 study that enrolled patients with stage 3 EGFR mutated non-small cell lung cancer and randomized them to either in a 2-to-1 fashion to either osimertinib or placebo. Important to note that the tumor assessments that were mandated in this study only consisted of chest CTs and MRI at baseline, but no PET or abdomen pelvis imaging required. So this potentially could suggest that there may be more advanced patients that could have been enrolled in this patient, you know, in this study, if for instance, more sensitive staging was employed. Primary endpoints for this study was PFS. And you can see here that the reason why it was in the plenary is because it passed the sort of the Kaplan-Meier truck test, and PFS was wildly positive with a hazard ratio of 0.16. Not entirely unexpected on the heels of the ADAURA data in the resected setting, again, showing similar magnitude of PFS benefit. Of course, one of the things that, you know, to note about the design of this study is that patients continue on the consolidative TKI indefinitely, you know, until disease progression. And when we look across the subgroups of patients in the study, again, generally favorable towards osimertinib across all the different subgroups. Interesting just to note that as we see as well in the metastatic setting, exon 19 deletion patients do better than L858R patients, but both of them derive significant benefit from the use of consolidative TKI. And you know, the a common critique of a study like this is what is the proper clinical endpoint in order to change the standard of care. There are some that will continue to advocate for overall survival, which is completely understandable in a curative setting clinical trial like this. But this slide I'm showing here to try to advocate for the fact that PFS is actually, in my opinion, the proper endpoint for this study. Because if you see the patients that actually did recur, for instance, in the control arm on the right, almost half of the patients recurred in the brain. And so having CNS-free, progression-free survival is clinically meaningful because that sort of brain progression can significantly change your overall survival trajectory. So, you know, as Dr. Alicia Sequist, who was the discussant at the plenary, mentioned, having overall survival as an endpoint for a study like this leaves significant numbers of patients behind who end up getting brain metastasis. And so the NCCN committee was quite quick in responding to these data and has already been, you know, the guidelines have already been updated to allow for consolidative osimertinib, again, until disease progression, as a category one recommendation for stage three and 2A for stage two. A big question that results from, you know, these positive data is what about the other actionable genomic alteration subtypes like ALK, ROS1, RET, HER2, for which we have targeted therapy that is highly effective? Do we need to run another randomized phase three study to demonstrate its efficacy in order to utilize those highly effective targeted therapies in this consolidative setting? I would advocate for no, but you know, this is definitely a very important question. And then in terms of ALK positive lung cancer, an area that I have particular interest in clinically and translationally, there was significant data in this space as well. So just to review the frontline options for ALK positive non-small cell lung cancer, as you may be aware, this is represents about 5% of non-small cell lung cancer, primarily in younger patients, you know, patients without a significant smoking history. So it is a bit of an embarrassment of riches for a disease group with a prevalence of 5%, in which we have multiple approved TKI options. So namely, lorlatinib per the CROWN study. All of these studies are not head-to-head studies. They are randomized to crizotinib, which is a first-generation TKI that is no longer the standard. So you see that first-line lorlatinib is available, and at the, you know, prior to ASCO, the updated data we had was that the median PFS was not reached at 3 years, and so it was comparable, at least at the time, to what is the most widely used TKI where available, which would be alectinib, with a median PFS of 35 months. And you know, I'm highlighting here that on the ALEX study in which alectinib was approved, the 5-year survival rate is over 60%. So trying to improve upon really, really highly effective therapy, this is what CROWN aims to do because of sort of a highly CNS penetrant, specially designed TKI in terms of lorlatinib. So this is a randomized global phase three study that enrolled metastatic ALK positive non-small cell lung cancer patients, and they were randomized to lorlatinib or crizotinib, as I had mentioned. The PFS was the primary endpoint. Again, really unprecedented survival results with the 5-year update that was presented at ASCO. So remember, at 3 years, median progression-free survival was not reached with a PFS rate of 65%. And at 5 years, median PFS was still not reached with a PFS rate of 60%. Only 5% decrement in PFS over the past 2 years. This sort of efficacy has never been seen in non-small cell lung cancer before in terms of TKI or any other targeted therapy. And where does it stack up in comparison to alectinib and brigatinib? I find that when discussing these data with patients, hazard ratios and relative risk reductions can be kind of tricky to comprehend. And so landmark PFS can be helpful. For instance, four-year landmark PFS for lorlatinib was 64% compared to 43% for alectinib. We don't have similar five-year data in terms of PFS published, at least for alectinib and brigatinib. And what is the driver of this significant benefit of lorlatinib? As I alluded to earlier, lorlatinib was designed specifically for better CNS activity. And this is really the major differentiator of this TKI because brain metastasis is a major, major problem in this particular lung cancer subtype. In fact, probably the most the subtype that has the most risk of brain metastasis, other than small cell lung cancer. And so you see here really dramatic results with lorlatinib in patients with and without baseline brain metastases. Quite striking is the Kaplan-Meier on the right. In patients without baseline brain metastases, there have only been four patients that have experienced brain metastases with a median of follow-up of 5 years. And in fact, in the intervening 2 years since the last update, there have been no new brain metastases in this disease, in this subgroup, really speaking to the potency of lorlatinib in protecting the brain, and also potentially suggesting that while lorlatinib is very effective in patients with brain metastases, it's utility may even be greater in patients without in order to actually continue a positive trajectory for survival. Of course, the reason why everybody's not using lorlatinib yet, despite this really encouraging and impressive data, is because of the toxicity considerations. Uptake of lorlatinib has indeed been tepid. And it's because the overwhelming majority of these patients will require a statin, edema, weight gain, neuropathy, CNS toxicity are things that are definitely real side effects with lorlatinib. But the Crown study, I think, provides some reassurance that these toxicities can be managed or are generally mild. So CNS adverse events occur in 42% of patients, but are overwhelmingly low grade. And, in my experience, not the thing that I worry the most about because they generally fairly quickly and respond very well to dose reduction or dose discontinuation. There was an ad hoc subgroup analysis in patients who had who required dose reduction in the Crown study, and those patients had no difference in terms of PFS and time to intracranial progression compared to patients who did not require dose reduction. Of course, those numbers are quite small, so some significant caveats there. So in terms of risk profile for patients who may experience significant cognitive toxicity for lorlatinib, retrospective data from our colleagues in Boston suggest that patients with brain metastasis or prior radiation, also who have concomitant usage of psychiatric medications, these are the patients that may experience the more severe cognitive side effects. As an aside, raising the question of whether or not radiation, as in, you know, SRS to asymptomatic small lesions, really is the right thing to do in this disease setting where we have highly active CNS penetrant TKIs. So how do we use lorlatinib in the clinic now, potentially? Who should we consider this for, given its significant toxicity concerns? You know, our group and others have done significant work in this area, trying to identify biomarkers to stratify the good ALKs versus bad ALKs. And so two key biomarkers have popped up consistently. One would be the EML4 ALK variant type, so variant 3 associated with decreased PFS and OS, PFS on second generation TKIs, and P53, similar to other actionable genomic alterations like EGFR, KRAS, also associated with poor outcomes, in particular overall survival. And so the interesting thing about the CROWN data is that CROWN may be able to abrogate the PFS issue with variant 3. As you see here on the curve on the left, in blue, patients with variant 3 compared to variant 1, which is the most common variant, generally seem to do about the same. And this is in contrast to the curves that you would see with brigatinib and alectinib. Patients with with P53 co-mutation generally just don't do as well overall. So I would say, if you needed a biomarker to try to prioritize patients with E4 lorlatinib, variant status may be something to consider, but that requires further prospective analysis. Moving on to the oligometastatic setting. So this is, you know, at ASCO, there was much anticipated data that was presented because local consolidative therapy, as you may be aware, has been adopted by many on the heels of positive overall survival data from randomized phase 2 studies, including the Gomez trial here on the top by my colleague Dan Gomez, previously at MD Anderson. And so we really needed more robust phase 3 data to justify the use of this practice. And also the previous randomized phase 2 data had a significant limitation in that none of them incorporated immunotherapy as part of their systemic backbone. So NRG LU002 is the pivotal study in this space. It enrolled patients with stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer who did not have disease progression after 4 cycles of systemic therapy and had less 3 or less sites of distant metastasis amenable to local consolidative therapy, primarily in the form of SBRT, but also potentially chemoradiation and or surgery. Primary endpoint here was PFS as a sort of a go, no-go endpoint in order to proceed to the phase 3 portion of this study. And important features in terms of the actual clinical population that ended up being treated on the study, overwhelming majority of these patients were indeed treated with an immunotherapy-based systemic regimen. But I want to call your attention to the fact that some of these patients actually had up to 25 lesions, metastatic lesions at baseline. For instance, multiple brain metastases that were treated with SRS and eventually reduced down to 3 or less oligometastatic sites at the time of randomization. So this is deemed induced oligometastatic disease. And as you can imagine, can be quite different in terms of biology if compared to, for instance, genuine oligometastatic disease in which patients only started with 3 or less distant metastases at baseline. And as we had heard in a press release prior to ASCO, this pivotal study was unexpectedly negative for progression-free survival and, of course, for overall survival. While there was a trend towards a delay in in-field recurrence and time to new lesion development, the overall intent-to-treat population did not derive benefit from the addition of local consolidative therapy, which goes against all of the previous randomized phase two data in contemporary cohorts. Again, not including immunotherapy in those data. Also important was that, as one might expect, patients who underwent local consolidative therapy had more toxicity, including more grade two or higher overall toxicity and higher rates of grade three pneumonitis, 10% versus 1%. So where does this lead us in terms of oligometastatic disease and local consolidative therapy? Is there still a role for local consolidative therapy for our oligometastatic patients? I think these data really highlight the complexity of oligometastatic disease. It just reaffirms that radiographic oligometastatic disease really represents heterogeneous biology, and that we really need better biomarkers to actually determine metastatic propensity at baseline in order to tailor local consolidative approaches. It's hard to see, I apologize, on the right, but the European group did an amazing job with this review and resulting consensus document, really breaking down the different types of oligometastatic disease in the granularity that is indeed required for us to actually conduct proper clinical trials moving forward. Again, for instance, being clear about genuine oligometastatic disease as opposed to induced, making a distinction between synchronous versus metachronous oligometastatic progression versus persistence. So that's what's ahead. And of course, there are ongoing subgroup and biomarker analyses for the NRG-LU002 study that will be helpful. And then finally, touching upon the unresectable malignant pleural mesothelioma space, I would say that we saw data at ASCO that affirms our current standard of care. So for background, as you may know, immunotherapy is an important option as a standard of care in this disease setting for first-line unresectable mesothelioma. And this comes from the CheckMate 743 study, which was a randomized phase three study that evaluated ipi/nivo in comparison to standard of care chemotherapy, which would be platinum pemetrexed. And it showed a significant overall survival benefit with a hazard ratio of 0.74. Important to note that this survival benefit was largely driven by the less common but more aggressive non-epithelioid histologic subtype. But patients with epithelioid mesothelioma still had a positive hazard ratio benefit. More recently, the Canadian group had an academic study that also affirmed the role of immunotherapy in the frontline setting. This was a study that randomized patients to platinum pemetrexed versus platinum pemetrexed plus pembrolizumab. So instead of dual IO, just pembrolizumab. And again, they were able to show an overall survival benefit, also primarily driven by the non-epithelioid subtype. So BEAT-MESO is an academic trial that was coordinated by our colleagues in Europe in the European Thoracic Oncology Platform Consortium. This is a randomized phase three study that enrolled patients with advanced pleural mesothelioma that was measurable by the meso resist. And the study randomized patients to standard of care chemotherapy plus bevacizumab. So as a reminder, this is a standard of care following on French data from several years ago showing overall survival benefit of the addition of bevacizumab when compared to chemotherapy alone, but not FDA approved, but is indeed an option in our NCCN guidelines. So that was the control arm in this study. And the question was, do you get improved survival if you add atezolizumab to this regimen? In terms of the patient characteristics enrolled in the study, one thing I would say is that it is actually quite representative of what we would expect in pleural mesothelioma. For example, the breakdown between epithelioid versus non-epithelioid, generally about 75% or so is epithelioid and 20-25% non-epithelioid. We also see sort of a expected breakdown in terms of PD-L1 expression. About half of patients with mesothelioma have PD-L1 positivity, although it is uncertain that it is a predictive biomarker in mesothelioma. And so the top line results for this study was that there was no overall survival benefit that was statistically significant, although you do see that it was numerically improved when adding atezolizumab to the backbone of chemo plus bevacizumab. It may be, you know, this result may have been impacted by the fact that significant percentage of these patients did receive subsequent immune checkpoint inhibitors upon progression. And also notable that the secondary endpoint of progression-free survival was positive with a hazard ratio of 0.72. So what does this mean in terms of the addition of IO? Well, same as what we saw with the previous randomized phase 3 studies. Now we have 3 randomized phase 3 studies that show that if you actually add IO, patients with non-epithelioid histology derive significant benefit. Patients with the more common epithelioid histology may derive some benefit, but clearly not to the same magnitude. So the current standard of care, in my opinion, remains the same. So for the more common epithelioid disease, I do prefer ipilimumab, nivolumab, if they are eligible for immunotherapies. In other words, they don't have an autoimmune disease or any other similar contraindication. But of course, if you're able to access carboplatin pemetrexed plus pembrolizumab, I think that would really be a reasonable option given the IND227 results. And of course, the standard of care here is the chemotherapy plus or minus bevacizumab backbone. For non-epithelioid disease, it is clear that these patients should be treated with an immunotherapy-based regimen. So in summary, lots going on in the lung cancer space in the past few months, 6 months. And so we're just really pleased to see this much progress for our patients. Importantly, and as it pertains to how it may impact your practice, tarlatamab is coming down the pike or is already here. It's just dependent on all of us at our cancer centers to try to figure out how do we actually deliver this care in terms of the logistics. Consolidative durvalumab is the new standard of care for our limited stage small cell patients. We also have consolidative TKI for our EGFR patients that should be used now. Lorlatinib is a tricky thing. I do believe that it should be a discussion for all our newly diagnosed advanced ALK positive patients, but of course some patients may not be suitable for that type of side effect profile. I don't think that LCT should be abandoned. It's just we do need more work to try to figure out which patients would truly benefit from that sort of more aggressive approach. And again, for unresectable mesothelioma, the standard of care remains the same, with IO-based regimens being reasonable, even for the epithelioid histology, just due to, you know, tolerance and other patient factors. So with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any questions if there's time.
So I guess at this point, are you ready to, for your second line small cell lung cancer patients, are you giving tarlatamab now as your drug of choice, or do you think there's the data strong enough to do that?
That's a great question. In fact, I have to look back at the label to know, to check to see if it mandates two lines or more prior therapy, because that's what the Delphi 301 study enrolled. But yes, if the FDA label allows, I would prioritize tarlatamab. You know, one thing that we've learned from all of our previous efforts in cell therapies, especially these nascent and emerging efforts in cell therapies for solid tumors, is that our patients are quite sick, you know, as they progress through different lines of therapy. And for these novel immunotherapies to be successful, these patients ideally should be treated with those as early as possible in their cancer journey. And it has a lot to do with immune, you know, T cell fitness and all those biologic factors, but also just plain, you know, performance status. So I would be in favor of using tarlatamab in the second line, also because of the promise of potential durable response. I mean, otherwise, I think your other option would be lurbinectedin, right? And that is really not expected to, or, you know, topotecan or, you know, that sort of thing. And those options are not expected to have any significant durable benefit. But the small cell lung cancer space is just exploding. I mean, we have new antibody drug conjugates that are showing positive data, preliminary positive data. B7H3 is one target that's very promising. SEZ6 presented preliminary data presented at ASCO. These are all just very encouraging for our small cell patients.
Any other questions?
It's you, Eric.
So I have two questions. The DERBA study after small cell, they saw that it was the H1C2, but there's very small numbers. And when you look at the curves, it's more questionable how positive it is. For H1C2 small cells, are you thinking that we should be or giving DERBA adjuvant, or is it something that?
Yeah, I mean, that's an excellent point, Eric. I mean, that's really the common question for all of these sort of curative intent, consolidative or adjuvant therapies. Do the early stage patients benefit from this additional therapy, which carries potential toxicity and of course cost? I would favor consolidative durvalumab for stage one, because we know that stage one small cell actually has a pretty high risk of recurrence still. And you know, one thing that's actually kind of curious is why durvalumab works better in this locally advanced or, you know, early stage setting compared to what we saw with Caspian, which is sort of the analogous study of durvalumab in extensive stage disease, which really had a modest PFS benefit, OS benefit of two months. And so that's just a long way of saying there may be something to do with radiation enhancing immunotherapy effects. So even just SBRT for stage one would potentially be quite helpful.
We see small cells in other areas outside of them. And there were so we've only been taking the lung data into these other areas. Do you think that's still like appropriate thing, or you know, we should be treating non-pulmonary also the same way for pulmonary, or no?
Yeah, I mean, I think we almost are We don't really have a lot of options in terms of not using the lung cancer data because the prevalence of these extrapulmonary small cell tumors are actually quite low relatively. So it makes a lot of sense to me to still continue to extrapolate from the lung data. I don't think we've seen anything. Again, small cell is not my primary area of focus, but I'm not aware of any data to suggest thus far that the extrapulmonary are biologically sort of significantly different in terms of, for instance, immunotherapy response. The transcriptional subsets that have been identified for pulmonary small cell lung cancer, I would think would apply. It's just we don't have the clinical data sets to validate that in the extrapulmonary diseases.
Any other questions?
So the question is kind of for comment around Tarla, and we're going to full disclosure in the self-engagement. But around your question about second line and third line, the group actually came in second line, the study that we showed was in third line. I think the FDA decided to give approval in second line, which is based on some of the data we did have in second line, first approval study. I think, like the talking line was just saying, based on the need for those patients and the taking them before they're too sick.
No, thank you for that. I'm actually curious for those in the audience who are, potentially representing their cancer centers, which cancer center in this area is actually available, for which tarlatamab is currently available? Because it's not at Hopkins.
CS is getting very close. They participate in a related system here, so they do have these patients that they have reduced as well. There's an area that are
commercial patients.
So NCS has had early access.
Yeah.
Same thing. A little bit more complicated. but yeah, but there's a couple of them that are pretty darn close.
Yeah, there's significant issues in terms of, for instance, reimbursement, for the inpatient stay, things like that, especially if you're in a state like Maryland with a capitated reimbursement setup. Yeah, so it's not very easy to implement. Well, it's not as easy as it seems. Hey, Bernie.
Hey, thank you so much. You're so envious of amazing progress, right? I was wondering, I may have missed it in that ADRAM study. Did they report subgroup for PD-L1?
I did not see the subgroup. They did. They did, sorry. Let me pull it up. But as you know, PD-L1 is not a reliable predictive marker in small cell. So I have to pull it up. Actually, no. I think that they had reported it, but it's not in the slide. Yeah.
In your study of what they call the oligometastatic disease, I don't think anybody would consider someone with 25 minutes or that event to be oligometastatic. So are you aware of any study that's looking at truly oligometastatic disease and the possible benefit of consolidating?
Yeah, so there are sort of extensions to the original Sabre-Comet study by David Palma that restrict to genuine oligometastatic disease, but they are in multiple tumor types. And of course, there are specific studies for actionable driver genomic alterations like EGFR, the so-called North Star study at MD Anderson, also the Bright Star study for ALK. So those are the data that I think would be quite helpful in terms of really honing in on the right subgroup that may benefit from LCT. not just the number of metastases, but also the biology, like for instance, EGFR and ALK. Like your LCT is potentially only as good as your systemic therapy. So if you have a highly effective systemic therapy, those may be eligible for or ideal for LCT, even if they had six metastases. Yeah, so there's a lot of work yet to be done.
Let me check the online
options. No questions. All right. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Lam.
Thank you.